Thank you, darling. Thanks, Daniel. Yeah. Crazy. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hi. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. Happy Monday. Good.
It's you've been going through this now for this 8 months of afternoon delight.
Yes. I know. This is like full circle. I feel like this is, it's weird because we shot it about a year ago this time.
And did you go, have you done festivals in between, or are you kind of?
We did, no, we did Sundance. That's the only festival I was able to go to. I think we've gotten into some other ones, but that I've been able to work, which is
working
awesome.
Is good.
It is good, but I'm excited to see it again tonight. I haven't seen it in a long time since Sundance.
So is that your goal, is to?
Work?
Work, is that being a working actor?
I would love to, yes. As long as they'll have me.
It doesn't seem like you're having a problem working.
No, it's happening, which is, I kind of feel like I'm going to, you know, I'm trying not to hold my breath, because otherwise then it'll be like radio silence. But it's been real, it's been awesome and busy for a second. It's been good.
So is it been
I guess that's what happens when you have two children, is all of a sudden the work starts, they start asking you to take your clothes off in every movie.
Is that your new thing?
And you have, that's going to be my new thing from now on. It's just tits out.
So 30-something and naked is kind of like when the agents
are looking
for the thing.
It's like the next age of Lena Dunham. I'm just going to keep, it's like her in 10 years and keep taking my clothes off.
I wonder whether Lena Dunham will be taking her clothes off in 10 years. Probably.
Yes, I hope so.
She'll probably be like Sally Kellerman. When she's 60, she'll be taking her clothes off.
She absolutely should. Do you know, yeah. I just saw the episode that her and Patrick Wilson won. Have you seen that?
It's the best one ever.
It's extraordinary.
Yeah.
It's like a one-act play. It's so good.
Well, they do one or two of those one-offs every year. And
What was the one on season one?
The one when they went to the parents' house, when they went to Peter Scolari and...
Home to Ohio or whatever. Yeah. Or not to Ohio, but yes. Oh, so good. Yes. Yeah.
The judge's comment when Scolari's nudity in that movie was, in that segment was, don't freeze frame. Just don't freeze the picture because you don't want to know.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
But yeah. They're always interesting.
Yeah.
So that was. So now, how does that? I mean, it seems very collaborative and very, arty farty, whatever, in the land of girls. But are you, as coming in as a guest actor for a number of episodes, do you feel part of that, or are you really just coming in to act? And
I mean, I totally. That was. It was season one, so I had the blessing of kind of walking into something like that was a little bit still untested and undiscovered. So it didn't feel like there was any like amazing, crazy cultural little amazing tea. Elf flying in. Thank you. So there wasn't like this weird cultural zeitgeist pressure yet. Like it was kind of undiscovered. I had seen Tiny Furniture and was obsessed with her and thought she was a comic genius and could not believe how fully formed that voice was out of such a young human being. I was I couldn't even balance a checkbook at her age. I mean, she's amazing. And they asked me to do it. They named the character Kathryn. It was like a, 4 or 5 episode arc. And I couldn't believe that she, on top of everything else, was able to then, as a young woman, get behind inside the head of a woman in her late 30s with two children. At that, I could not believe that she was able to be inside that woman also, and so specifically and clearly. That scene really moved me, the scene between Kathryn LaFoy, the person I played, and Jemima, really killed me and was so specific. I don't know, she's a witch, that Lena Dunham. She's like a shaman. I don't know how she does it. She's like, it's amazing, that mind. She's brilliant.
So it's when you got that script was fully, wholly formed, and that's really what you shot.
I think I improvised the dream that I talked about, the like jealousy dream. But everything else, yeah, fully formed.
So has it been a rocky or a mountainous road for you? I mean, do you feel like there have been times? And
I still feel like, that they're gonna take away my SAG card. That I'm gonna go. I still can't believe that I'm able to call myself a working actor. That was always, my dream of dreams since I was a kid in Cleveland. I was a curtain puller at the Cleveland Playhouse, and I did a little show there called Hickory Hideout. which I talked to two squirrels named Nutso and Shirley Squirrely. They were puppets. We shot at our local news station, and
it's old school.
It was so old school. Yeah, those, like, you know, the, like, newsroom lights? Like, that's what it was. And then they just kind of, like, brought, like, slid in a fake tree that was our treehouse, and then would slide it away.
So were you an adult at that point, or were you a teenager?
No, I was a child. This is when I was in, like, sixth grade.
Okay, you're really a child.
Yeah, this is, like, no, like, fourth grade through sixth grade. Mm-hmm. And then I went to, you know, then I was just a theater kid. Like, I went to Northwestern, and then went to Yale grad school. And
Les Hendricks?
Where?
Les Hendricks at Northwestern.
Oh, yeah, I know that name. Yeah. Yes.
One of the teachers, yeah.
No, I had Bud Beyer, but I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
That's amazing. So I always thought I was going to have this career in New York City, in New York City theater. And my first gig out of Yale was Crossing Jordan, which unexpectedly took me out to California. I did not expect to be there as long as I was, or that show would last as long as it did. But I'm so grateful to have been able to pay off my loans, God knows.
Now, see, I unfortunately was never a fan of Crossing Jordan, or didn't watch Crossing Jordan. So
fine, fair enough. Let's not beat around the bush.
Horrible.
What do you mean, cruel or horrible?
People
have opinions.
Well, you know.
Honey,
it wasn't,
please.
I just didn't watch it.
Fine, fair enough.
I was, you know, all Jill Hennessy'd up.
Yes, fine.
I'd see her on Montana Avenue. That was enough for me. I was pleasant just seeing her on a weekend.
Fine. Fine.
Randomly across the street. But was it
so a sweetie,
quote unquote, Kathryn Hahn character, or was it something that we wouldn't expect from?
I mean, I don't know this. I don't know what exactly that means, but I will tell you, I played the grief counselor in the morgue.
Mm-hmm.
So my role consisted of me consoling another a different guest actor every week.
Were you funny?
I was not. I mean, as funny as I was allowed to be, but it was like a classic procedural drama. You know, so there wasn't a lot of room for it. Was like my character was as quirky as you could get.
Mm-hmm.
Although there was a couple of other quirky characters, like there's two other like quirky guys that worked in the morgue. But it was like as quirky as one could get in the definition of what that show is to a
so did
network
you think
television
of yourself
series.
As a funny person at that point, or a foreign funny actress, or were you?
I mean, I'll be honest with you. I was always like the class clown, and I think I always was. I should have realized when, you know, I went in Yale, for example, I was always cast as like Grandma in Grapes of Wrath. And I should have maybe.
Want to be Tom Joad or?
Right. I was like, where's Rosa Sharon? So I feel like there should have been some sort of maybe an inkling that was maybe where my life was going to go. But I've always thought of myself, I mean, I always, you know, certainly didn't start this business looking for just comedy jobs in any way. It just kind of happened.
But they're never really straight comedy jobs with you. It's always...
Mm-mm. I guess, no. She's always like a little bit on the verge.
Something. And is that you? You seem very relaxed for somebody who's on the verge. You're not...
You know, that's kind of why I love what I get to do is, you know, as kind of straight-laced as I am maybe in my regular real life, two kids, a gorgeous husband, we've been together forever. Like, there's kind of a lawlessness about the roles that I've gotten to do, like an anarchic
mm-hmm.
quality that I like to just, I feel fearless in my on-screen life that I'm not able to do in my real life.
Well, it does seem that some actors...
It's not healthy, I'm saying, it's just what it is.
Well, like even Juno, ironically, in this movie with you, another one who I think the directors and producers figured out was fearless and would
yeah.
go anywhere and started getting cast like that all the time. And I think probably the same situation
yeah.
with you, where there's like somebody who's actually willing to bite it all off and chew on it. It's pretty rare.
Yeah. I mean, I for better or for worse, like I don't think I have like a very typical actress vanity.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that I the second I start worrying about that stuff, I get in my head. That's not my currency. I don't like looking at monitors or playback. I don't think Juno does either. I just don't want to like be conscious in that way. I guess as a performer, I like the heaven for me is when you're with somebody that you that just feels safe, and that there's the flow is happening, no matter what genre it is. You know, mm-hmm. I don't care. And I love a good relaxed open set. I love a crew. I'm from Ohio, so I love the environment, like the ensemble mm-hmm. environment.
So how did Jill come to you with this particular?
My manager sent me the script, and I was so moved by this character. I thought, it wasn't like I was looking for a lead. It wasn't like I was looking for something of this tone. The story just killed me. Just killed me. And it really was, for some reason, I felt incredibly, just empathized with her. Like, I had a lot of empathy for this character. I'm also, like, live in Silver Lake, you know, like half a mile from where we shot this. I have two kids. My kids go to the same JCC for classes as Jill's kids. Like, it's such a crazy small world.
So did you know Jill before all
of this? No, I mean, we had, like, our paths had kind of crossed. Mm-hmm. I mean, we knew of each other, but, and I loved her writing, but yeah, we never met.
So you loved the script, and then do you just sit and have lunch?
And then I like begged. No, we Skyped. She took my Skype virginity. I'd never done Skype before. I was in New York shooting The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, and we did a Skype session very late at night. One night, I had to be really quiet because the kids were asleep. You know, we were in, you know, an awesome, very amazing small corporate apartment, and I had to be really hushed and beg for it over the internet.
And was it, so it wasn't love at first sight, or it was easy, or was this?
I mean, it was certainly love at first sight for me, I'm sure. Yeah, I wanted it, I really loved this part, and I think so. And she's an incredible brain, I just wanted to get in there. And I knew, even if this was her first feature, she just came at it with such crazy confidence that I knew it was going to be something specific and special. It was definitely not going to be like wishy-washy. Like she just has such incredible, just innate confidence.
And you're diving deep into it. Was just, that's the way you work anyway.
I guess so. Yeah, we were just able to go there together. It was just like Jim Frohna, the DP, was instrumental. Everything kind of worked out. Like, the original DP couldn't do it, so Jim stepped in, and he ended up being exactly who should be there. Like, everything just kind of, like, worked out.
Want something like
used
Mini,
my minivan, for example.
Is that your minivan?
Yes, it's my hot Honda Odyssey.
Did you get paid a per diem for it?
No, damn it.
Damn it.
I know.
You should be getting back-end money.
As it were, exactly.
So in something like Walter Mitty, which is, there's a big machine and you're part of it.
Yeah, exactly.
Is the work the same, or are you recalibrating how you?
No, the work is, it's always the same. It's, you know, and that's like, that's the hard about how, that's the difficult thing about how to actually, like, how do you pay a performer? Because I think the level of work and the quality has to be the same no matter what you're getting. You know what I mean? You don't want to tell producers that. But I think it has to be. You're not going to, and for anybody working as well, like, you're not going to, mm-hmm. it's a small world. So you're not going to want to, you can't just, no one can really phone anything. And I wouldn't want to, like, these experiences are so finite, and your career is actually, you only have, life is so, you know, life is short, my dear. But you really want, I don't want to, like, waste an opportunity, because I know how lucky I am. I, you know, even going to Yale, like, I had an incredibly talented class, and incredibly talented. And I know that it's just certain switches of the dial, like, you know, I'm just so grateful to be working.
Well, do you feel anything off of this movie at this point, or is it still, or you have so many things going on in the balls in the air?
I do. I mean, I'm doing this pilot I'm really excited about with the Showtime pilot with Philip Seymour Hoffman that John Cameron Mitchell's directing, that I know that they had seen parts of this, so I'm sure that helped them crack it open for me, mm-hmm. was seeing this. So we'll see. Yeah. I mean, I love being in the comedy world, and that's wickedly funny, this pilot. And
are you part of his world, like John Cameron Mitchell? Are you part of that indie?
Not yet, but yeah, I will be. We'll start in a week. I'm very excited.
But I mean, you're not, are you socially part of all that?
No, I'm out here. My life's out here. They're they're New Yorkers.
But like, so like film independent out here, and there's like that whole Independent Spirit Awards group.
Yes. I mean, I wouldn't say, I still feel like I'm going to maybe get kicked out of the party, but I'm kind of like on the outskirts with two kids and my Honda Odyssey. It's not as cool, but it's there.
And you got another movie going to Toronto.
Yeah, Bad Words, which is Jason Bateman's.
Because you don't work very much.
Directorial feature. It was just taken away. Yeah, I'm really proud of him for that one. That's his directorial feature. That's so great.
Did you know him before? Was that part of the...
We had known each other. We had actually met at a dinner. And then very, I mean, out of sweetly asked me to be his leading lady. So exciting. So I was really thrilled by that because that was something that has not been asked of me either. And it's a really fun part.
Are you actually surprised by these things still?
Yes.
I mean, it's interesting because your career is kind of...
Yes.
People know you, even if they don't know your name all the time.
You know, yes. They know you. I guess it's a lot of like, did we go to high school together? And yeah. I'm like, maybe.
But, I mean, you are a person, I mean, you're recognizable, identifiable, energy level, you know.
I mean, I am, yes. I mean, I feel like things have shifted and a little. I definitely feel a shift in my career. I feel... I do feel like a confidence shift starting to happen. I think that doing this movie was a huge one for me. But I also feel like it was, I think it happened exactly the timing that obviously it was supposed to happen because it is what it is, A. Mm-hmm. And how can you even try to look at something in retrospect and there's nothing pre-planned about this career, God knows, but I think... maybe I wouldn't have been ready until last year to take on these parts. Like maybe I just like confidence-wise needed to feel like that I was actually supposed to be here and that, yeah.
So was this movie harder than other movies? Was it, I mean.
This was the hardest thing I'd, yes, ever.
Because you're very raw, ultimately.
Yes, I think this was the hardest thing I'd ever done because of the amount of, it was very surreal too because I just did this movie this summer, this out called We're the Millers, which is a very different genre. And we were shooting that in Wilmington, North Carolina at the same time that I was doing this movie here. So I was like flying there, putting on a fanny pack and my like shape ups and my, it was like surreal, granny panties. And then like flying back here and doing this. And that was surreal. I'm the best. Like that's what you dream about as an actor is that kind of scale and be able to play pretend in those ways was nuts, but this was the hardest because we did 6 day weeks. You know, I'd never been in like basically every day, every scene. And you're right, it was some pretty raw places that I don't think we anticipated or that I certainly didn't anticipate. Yeah. We were on fumes by the end of it.
So was going off to play with Nick kind of vacation from this while you were doing it? Is that
my God, I love him.
Not just that you guys are funny, but you do steal every scene you guys are in.
Just like him with that mug. When he walked out of the for the hair and makeup test and he just had that stash on and his shorts, his amazing white socks pulled up, I was like, okay, hello, Mr. Fitzgerald. He was like, hello, Mrs. Fitzgerald. We just took off. It was heaven. I love him madly.
So how did you enjoy...
Sexiest man alive, I heard.
In some quarters, he is. People absolutely adore him in ways that I think
and his, make him... definitely sexiest wife on the planet.
Yes. Well, he loves his wife. He'll talk about
as
your
he
wife
should. She's
much
amazing.
Longer than he will about talking about himself.
Oh, she's incredible.
Much rather talk about her than
himself. He's like deflect. But they're both amazing.
So how did you and Jill work together? Was there a long process before you started shooting?
No, we had a couple of meetings in her. She rented this awesome bungalow and for like the production office, like near where we lived, and we, because we live like really close to each other, we kind of just like would get together and have tea and just beat out the script a little bit or just talk about it and make each other laugh a lot. And I read for some women to come in to play, the friend part, Stephanie, and which was already surreal because I knew every actress that came in. I just like auditioned with them last week, and I was like, "Hey guys, this is so weird." Then they're all amazing, and I also learned a ton as an actor through that too because they were all, you know, incredible. And anyway, so we, and then I think just through that process of talking and beating out the script, we just started getting closer and closer. And then once it started and the train took off from the station, the production started, then it was no time at all that we felt, that it felt real, real easy with each other and safe.
So do you like, you want to find it on this while you're on the set? I mean, when, as the scenes are being shot, is
I'm
that
not like a big
really
talker. I mean, contrary to the mouth that's happening right now, I'm actually don't like to really talk about scenes or overthink it, because I'm not the most articulate. And also, I think that if I try to say it, it dilutes it. Like, I would rather just experience it. And I don't know if that sounds real precious, but it's just
everybody has a different way of working. I mean, that's the thing. It's so dramatically different from
the
actor.
Yeah, exactly.
When they find that thing.
Yeah, that's at least how it was for this experience. I we've just found it. Oh, excuse me, my ride. we found it real. It happened really fast, and Juno was a huge part of it. And that chemistry, we just kind of fell for each other so immediately. And she's a treasure. And I think that we really brought out something special in each other. I'm so proud of the two of us. And Josh Radnor, I'm really, really, really impressed by him in this movie.
Yeah. Well, it's hard. I mean, I think it's interesting with Juno, who we've shot many times.
Yeah.
So let's talk to Juno a lot, but it's like she gets these parts where she's the girl who takes her clothes off, and it's easy to get distracted by that. And I watched this movie again yesterday, and I was like kind of blown away by how great she is in it.
She's so good in this movie. I know. And she's so...
it's all very subtle. It's always little things that she's... You know, she signals with her eyes in this movie a lot because she hasn't got the dialogue for it. She's just kind of like...
I know, but you believe in this person, and you know that... I mean, she's extraordinary in this movie, I think. Yeah, I agree.
So do you know when you're on a set like this that something great has happened or something wonderful has happened? Or?
Yeah, you know it in the moment. Like, you know, like when... You know when we're, you know, when you absolutely, when Juno and I have some of those scenes together, when that starts to happen, when that engine is going, and when the, like, you know something special's happening, yeah. And you know when the crew's invested, that's a huge, huge sign. If they're like, then you're like, uh-oh, what's going on, guys? If you're not interested now, how's this gonna translate?
So 6 months later, you finally saw the movie, or?
Yeah, I was a little bit involved. You know, Jill would let me come into the editing suite sometimes, and we did some like ADR and some. So I was able to see it in a lot of different versions. But I'm really impressed by that Jill Soloway.
So when you finally saw it with an audience, were you nervous, or you already kind of?
I was terrified. I mean, I was the first time I'd seen it with an audience was at Sundance at that huge theater. And I remember, like, sitting next to my husband, and then as it started, I started, like, all of a sudden, like, I started seeing all the scenes that were coming up and being like, oh, my God, oh, my God, oh, my God. Like, I kept thinking, like, actually what would be actually seeing on camera is a little terrifying.
So was the audience comforting? Or was your husband comforting?
He was the sweetest, and he had heard all about it. And, yeah, it was a really out-of-body evening and one of those, like, crazy pinch me moments. I'd never been to Sundance before.
Huh. Yeah. Which is miraculous, really, when you think about it.
Oh, I don't know.
Well, given your career, miracles. You would think you were in that Sundance every year.
I want to go back as a fan, though. That was so, it was awesome. I mean, I had a really, really amazing time. There seemed to be some incredible movies that I really wanted to see.
So when the premiere turned out to went pretty well, say, understated a little bit, was that just joy? Was it relief? Was it...
Oh, yeah, it was all of those things. I mean, this was a huge, gorgeous investment. Like we were talking about before, like I have two little peanuts now. I have a 4-year-old and a 6-year-old, and this was certainly one that was for the absolute just work of it. Like it was just for the absolute, like there was nothing, no other reason except for creatively, like this was going to be one of those that are few and far between. And it was, like I said, like the toughest I'd ever done. I was proud. I was proud to say that this is that I was so excited to see it put together, and I just think Jill got together such a crazy good group. I mean, I saw it when I did a little looping recently, and Jessica St. Clair, who plays my pal Stephanie, is so good in it and so important. To have that color, to have that brightness, like, is so imperative. And you know, a lot of those scenes were just improvised between us, and we really felt like pals. It was great.
So do you read reviews?
I do sometimes, and sometimes not. This was so close to me that it was hard.
So was that experience, I mean, your reviews were all good, I think. Anybody dislike you in this movie? I don't think that's really possible.
I don't know, honey. There might have, but no matter, yes, but we were just talking about that before in the last interview too, is, and what I'm going to try to learn, like, you know, going forward in this, is that, you know, if you believe in the good, then you have to believe in the bad, and vice versa. Like, I think it's impossible not to read them. Mm-hmm. I think when people say that, I'm like, you're lying. but you just have to put them in perspective. I know it's an opinion.
So you weren't floating on air when you were reading? You were talking how wonderful you were?
What if I was like, yeah, I still am.
You were just cool.
I'm so as slick, as cool as a kid. I was like, yes, exactly. No, I'm just not that. I'm always, can't wait for the next one. Like, nothing has ever felt like the thing. Like, I've never felt like, oh, okay. You know, I'm just grateful to, I mean, honestly.
So even this is not the thing. Or something.
It's a thing.
It's special.
And it's special, but I don't know if it's the thing. But it's a thing. It's a really, really important one to me and to my life. Yeah.
So do you think about what you want to be doing or where you want to be as an actress in 5 years or 10 years?
I mean, hopefully doing this amazing television show with Mr. Hoffman and company. I hope that's happening. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But and I mean, are you a careerist at all? Do you think about, you know, what you want for yourself or your career and as the future goes on, or are you kind of like...
You know, I haven't had the luxury of being able to be like, this is the next step, or I'm plotting this out, or this is what's... I hope to continue to work with people that I'm just inspired by, and I hopefully the next chapter I can afford to... I'm very excited to just pick the work that my entire self just wants to do, that I'm excited about doing, that I'm passionate about doing. I've been lucky, like, even if some of the movies, like, I've done some big, you know, awesome studio comedies that maybe haven't been, like, beloved by the critics. But they have meant as much as these. Like, there's something in every one. I mean, I've been blessed to really work with some awesome human beings, and I've been challenged, and I hope I continue in that department. I'd love to go back and do a play when my kids get a little older, and having a little peanut, like, my kids are still so young that this is such a crazy short time that I want need to A, pay for private school, but B, want to make sure that that I can, when I'm away from them, if I can, be proud of, really, really proud of what I'm doing. I know, like, a lot of parents, like, don't have that luxury, so, but if I can, that would be the dream.
But for you, the real core excitement is what you're doing on the set, on the stage, as it's happening. Not the prep, not the what happens to the movie, whether it's a big hit or not a big hit or whatever. You're really all
I have
that.
An awesome group of people that I love and pay percentage to to worry about those awesome things. Prep, I love. I love research. I love costumes. I love all that business. Like, that is that's the good stuff. But and I've been witness to the star of the movie that has had to deal with that kind of of course, understandably. Mm-hmm. And I've just never had to worry about that. Mm-hmm. But I, is that articulate in any way?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I'm not sure you finished, but it was...
No, I just stopped myself midway. I was like...
So you're a little ambivalent about that part of it.
mean, these are such interesting questions. No, of course you want your movie to do well and make money and be seen. Yes, of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Of course. Oh my God. Yeah.
But you don't. It's not the thing that you. It's not that you don't get pleasure in
numbers.
Worrying about that, thinking about it, waiting for numbers
like results
on Saturday morning or Friday.
Yeah. No. No.
You already had your experience when you made the movie.
Yeah, I think so. I do. I mean, yes, that has never, like we talked about before, like that's just never been my currency as a performer. I'm just not as turned on by that myself. That doesn't concern me as much as the experience of hopefully making a good, this term always sounds crass, but I want the product to be good. Like, absolutely, I want to feel like it's a quality, that it's quality and that it's explored and lived in. And I get really impatient with any kind of laziness. Like, I love the work of it. I love it, love it, love it. Maybe that comes from the theater, but like a lot of actors that I admire have that same work ethic. And still like a learning curve.
But it sounds like your soul satisfaction is, your heart satisfaction is, you did your job. You had the experience. You got to spend the time with the other artists creating something, even if it's silly or whatever.
Yes, and I also feel like I never feel like walking away from something that I feel like nailed it. Sometimes it's very rare that, but it's because it's such a, that's the beauty of it, is that it's finite. Like you work for a short amount of time and you're trying to create, like, it's a crazy, amazing job. My favorite performances, like I think about some like of these amazing female performances and I think like, oh, that happened in such a short amount of time that they were able to, it's just a miracle to me when it works. It's like I'm such a huge fan of movies, and I just saw, like, for example, I just saw Woman Under the Influence again very recently, and I was like, oh my God. I mean, extraordinary. It's just such a miracle that something like that can happen in that short amount of time. I'm very excited to see Blue Jasmine. I heard it's
But when you think of something like Jenna, 40 years later, it's still that performance that took place over a week in a, two weeks. It's still worth having the conversation.
It's not still like worth having in one person's house with probably a skeleton crew. Their house.
Yeah.
Husband directing it. I know, like, makes me want to bawl thinking about it. Like, how does that happen? Like, that's when you think, like, oh, that's the aspiration. It's like how something like that magical can happen in that amount of time that still, right, that we still think about. And you're right, they shot it in like 2 seconds.
Yeah. No money.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Tripping over wires to get breakfast in the morning. Like, it just, you think about that and you're like, oh. And then they like, I know. Those are the ones we talk about too. It's interesting.
Yep.